This is a bolt, but what kind of bolt is it? Now, as mechanics, we will be able to tell if this is an inch or a metric bolt just by looking at it. And this will help us find a replacement or narrow down what wrenches we might need. As machinists, we will use these same skills to help us determine which tap to use, to be able to use this bolt on a fixture or with a mating part. And as engineers, this same knowledge will help us choose the right strength bolt for the job. The fasteners that we use are hiding some secrets from us in plain sight, so stick around as we look at the tools and methods that we can use to identify and even machine lots of these screws and bolts in this Haas tip of the day.
Everything for me begins with my setup sheet. So check this out. I've got a block loaded up. Now if you're tightening up those tools by hand,
here in the United States, we will carry both inch and metric tools depending on the machines that we are working on. And in lots of cases, we will find both inch and metric fasteners on the same piece of equipment. This is especially common on specialty vehicles where there are lots of aftermarket parts from different vendors. Now, this Mustang is being built for performance, and we had some fun checking out the modifications, pointing out the different hardware and identifying them at a glance. Now that is an inch bolt. That is a metric screw. Metric, inch, inch, kind of a low grade bolt. Inch, that's a really strong bolt. Here is our secret. The quickest way to tell if a bolt is metric or inch is to look at the grade that is stamped right into the head of the bolt. Now, this system is fascinating, okay? And it might seem just theoretical to us machinists and mechanics, but it really is a hidden superpower with some practical applications. Metric bolts make use of a class system that contains a decimal point. Now, the integer before the decimal point represents its tensile strength, which is just the maximum strength that a material can handle before breaking. If we stress a bolt beyond its tensile strength, it will simply tear in half. Now this bolt is marked 8.8. The 8 before the decimal means that it can handle 800 newtons per square millimeter of stress before it fails, which is the same as 800 megapascals. Now don't worry, there is no quiz. This is just a big picture overview. Now this bolt is a metric class 10.9. And the 10 means it can handle 1,000 megapascals before it snaps. And this screw is rated a 12.9, and it has a tensile strength of 1,200 megapascals. So you get the idea. The larger the number, the stronger the bolt. Now the number after the decimal point represents its minimum yield strength. A 0.8 would signify an 80% yield strength. A 0.9, a 90% yield strength. And here's what we mean by yield strength. If a bolt were made of glass, besides being easy to break, it would have almost no stretch to it. Now, we need our bolts to have some elasticity, some stretch to them, to act like a spring when tightened, given a constant preload to our assemblies, keeping things tight. Now, if we were to tighten a real bolt, it would actually stretch by some small amount. And when the bolt was loosened, it would return to its original shape. But if the bolt is stretched too far, put under too much stress, it will permanently deform. It will have lost its elasticity, and the fastener cannot be reused. This is called plastic deformation. So our yield strength is the minimum amount of stress needed to cause our bolts to deform permanently. And on metric bolts, this is listed as a percentage of tensile strength. Tensile strength, yield strength. Tensile strength, yield strength. So let's make use of this newfound information. We are separating these bolts into two piles, inch and metric, just by looking for a grade stamping on their heads. Done. Now these bolts have the metric class number stamped into them that we would recognize, and these do not. And this third pile, we'll just ignore that for a moment. So For inch bolts, SAE hexagon bolts, hex bolts, we will often find radial lines stamped onto the heads. No lines means grade 2, 3 lines means grade 5, and 6 lines means grade 8. The more lines, the stronger the bolt. The tensile and yield strengths of these bolts can be found in reference manuals like the Machinery's Handbook and the Fastener's Black Book and others. Now, in regards to socket head cap screws, our metric socket head cap screws are stamped on the heads with their class, like 12.9. But an inch socket head cap screw often has no marking on it at all. It's completely blank, or it may have a bunch of numbers and letters that make no sense to us and really don't tell us anything at all. These are often manufacturer numbers that just fit into their own catalog, and we can't really use them. So just look out for the metric numbers and we'll go from there. But all inch socket head cap screws are still very, very strong, about 20% stronger than a classic grade 8 bolt. They are on par strength-wise with a metric class 12.9. There are lots of exceptions to the rules that we just laid out. In fact, many screws with diameters smaller than about 5 millimeters or so might have no markings on them whatsoever. But in general, if your screws have numbers on them like this, it's metric. And if they've got lines stamped on them like this, then they are inch. These are all kinds of different screw checkers, and they can tell us exactly what kind of bolt or screw that we have, so we can find replacements or choose the right tap. Now, I've been using the terms bolt and screw interchangeably, but technically there is a difference. Normally, a bolt is intended to be used with a nut that can screw onto it, while a screw is meant to thread directly into a fixture or a part of some kind. Now, with that said, there are so many exceptions to this rule that the line between what we call a bolt and a screw is really no longer clear. Okay, so that's out of the way. Now, we've got some plastic screw checkers right here. These inexpensive plastic screw checkers are the kind that we might find at a hardware store. We take our bolt and test fit it in each hole, moving from large to small, until the bolt no longer fits. The last hole that the bolt did fit in is the correct size. And look at this. Even these cheap plastic gauges are listing out our SAE and our ISO grades to help us tell the difference between inch and metric bolts. And we'll see this on quite a few of our gauges. Listed right here, and again here, because it's super useful information. Now, these plastic gauges can do a good job of telling us what size bolt we have, the diameter, but that's not enough information to buy a replacement screw or choose a tap. There's more information to these threads than we can get from that gauge. In fact, there's 4 basic pieces of information that we need in order to choose the correct bolt. Number 1, we need the major diameter. Number 2, our thread minor diameter. Number 3, our thread angle, which is typically 60 degrees for a common screw. And number 4, our pitch, which is the distance between each thread. Metric bolts are generally called out by their diameter and their pitch. An M12 by 1.75 bolt would have a diameter of 12 millimeters and a pitch of 1.75, the distance between each thread in millimeters. Now, inch bolts are usually called out by their diameter, followed by the number of threads per inch. This 5/8-11 bolt has 11 threads per inch. Now, if we had nothing but a scale or a set of calipers, we could measure out 1 inch and then count the number of full threads within that single inch. Now, it's important that we count only full threads when checking our threads per inch visually. Screws smaller than 1/4 inch diameter here in the US use a special numbering system, our Unified Thread Standard, with numbers like 10, 8, 6, and so on. these screws start with zero, which actually comes in at 60 thou diameter, and they move up in 13 thou increments per reference number. These plastic gauges gave us our thread diameter, but they didn't give us our pitch or our threads per inch. These more sophisticated steel screw checkers can give us that information. We will move from hole to hole, large to small, until we find our size. And then we will try threading in the screw to find our correct pitch. M10 by 1.5, 1 quarter by 20. By 32 threads per inch. Different thread pitches might be available for the same size screw, and these could be noted as coarse, medium, fine, and extra fine. Now, this is a good time to tell the tale of British Airways Flight 5390. Now, it's an incredible story. Back in 1990, a commercial aircraft took off from Birmingham in the UK. A commercial aircraft got up to cruising altitude, and 15 minutes into the flight, there was a loud bang. And the left windscreen of the aircraft popped off, was ripped from the plane, and the co-pilot was torn from his seat and almost went out the window. His legs got caught on the control, and then he was saved by a steward who grabbed onto his legs mid-flight. Now, the co-pilot passed out, but they made their way to another airport and landed the airplane with the pilot, co-pilot, halfway out of the plane. Now, the story did have a happy ending. They got him to the hospital, he fully recovered, and he was flying that plane again 5 months later. But what happened? What caused this incident in the first place? Well, the day before that flight, the aircraft was in maintenance, and it was having that windscreen replaced with 90 screws that were supposed to have been the equivalent of a 1032 screw, 32 threads per inch. But what was put in were 832 screws, which are 26 thousandths of an inch diameter smaller than they should have been. So 15 minutes into the flight, those screws started popping out one by one, and they lost the windscreen. So this all could have been prevented by, well, you guessed it, this guy right here. In a machine shop where we aren't just identifying screws, but machining them, we will rely on an entirely different set of tools. Now, for quick reference, we will use our pitch gauges to visually check our thread pitch. We are just checking for any daylight between our gauge and our threads. For a clearer, more accurate picture of our thread angles and our thread pitch, we may use an optical comparator to inspect our male threads. We will make use of micrometers and pin gauges to measure our major and minor thread diameters, making sure they fall within the range specified on our prints and reference standards. Now, there's a feature to our threads that we haven't mentioned yet. It's called our pitch diameter, and we're going to need some special tools in order to measure that. It's a theoretical diameter right in between our major and minor threads. Measuring our pitch diameter helps us control our class of fit as well, how loosely or tightly our threads will fit together. On external threads, we can use thread wires and some math to measure this, or we can make use of pitch micrometers that are specially designed and calibrated for the task. On internal threads, we are going to make use of gauge pins to measure our minor diameters, and we'll use go, no-go thread pitch gauges to check those internal thread pitch diameters. Being able to identify any thread and really understanding how they're being measured and defined is a huge part of what it means to be a machinist. So we're happy that you were able to explore this topic with us. Thanks for letting us be a part of your success, and for watching this Haas Tip of the Day.